This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, let's start. Hope it's audible to everyone. Okay. Right, so let's start. So we were discussing this drop-down list boxes in selection screen. So in the last example, when I execute this, by default, all the three blocks are what? Invisible. Okay, all the three blocks are invisible. Right, so on selecting a value in the drop down list box, after selecting the value, we are pressing enter key so that SAP triggers what? At selection screen event. In that event, we are identifying the selected value and we are setting one variable to what? Some 1, 2, 3 kind of thing. Then, after at selection screen, SAP triggers an event called as at selection screen output. In that event, we are writing the logic to refresh our selection screen. So when I press enter, yes, I got the appropriate block. So if I choose locations, I'll press enter, I got the appropriate block. Okay, so let me make a copy of this program. Let us do some changes. This 34, I'll copy to 35. Done. Let me activate this. Done. Now my requirement is, see here we are selecting the value in the drop down and we are pressing enter key. Only after pressing enter key only the appropriate block is made what? Visible. The appropriate block is made visible. Now my requirement is, the moment I select a value, okay, the moment I select a value in the drop down, the appropriate block should be made what? Visible. That is the requirement. Okay, so if I choose locations, the locations block should be made visible. If I choose courses, courses block should be made visible without pressing what? Enter key. Okay, so for that, what you have to do is, we have to associate function code for the drop-down list box. Already we know how to associate function code for the what? Push buttons, check boxes, and radio buttons. Now we need to associate the function code with the drop-down list box. So the change I'll do is, as part of my declaration, as part of declaring the list box, I will use the addition user command. So here I'll say user command. I'll give the function code as something FC1. Okay. So I'm associating function code for the drop down list box. So when I do syntax check, I got an error for a parameter defined with the user command. Okay. For a parameter defined with the user command, neither offset nor length specifications are allowed. So what it is saying is, if you are using user command option, if you are using user command option for the parameter statement, we should not specify the offset or we should not specify the length itself. So here we are specifying the length, that's why it is giving what? An error. So what I have to do is, I cannot do like this. So let me do syntax check. Sorry, let me comment this. Right, so parameters p underscore abc. So what I'll do is, since I should not give any length here, if you're defining user command, I'll take a separate variable. I'll give a variable name as something gv underscore GV underscore ABC of 15, type what? C. I declared a separate variable GV underscore ABC of 15 type C. Then I'll say parameters P underscore ABC. Here I will refer to my existing variable like GV underscore ABC. Okay, so I repeat, whenever we use user command option, whenever we use user command addition as part of parameters, we should not specify the length itself. So that's the reason I declared a separate variable of what character of 15, and then I declared what parameter variable referring to that what our own variable. Now when I do syntax check, yeah, I don't have any error. So why I'm associating the function code for my list box? The moment I select a value without pressing the enter key, the appropriate block should be made visible. Okay, done. I've associated the function code. What is the function code name here? FC1. And yesterday we have discussed whenever we select a value in the drop down list box. Okay, whenever we select a value in the drop down list box. Okay, what is the event triggered? At selection screen is the event triggered. So what I'll do is here, this is the initialization event, and in that selection screen event, we know that the function code is captured in what? The system field sciucom. So I'll say case sciucom, case sciucom, when, what is the function code we have associated? FC1. So when FC1, do so and so, end for case is what? End case. So what is the only change I'm doing is, I'm attaching the function code for my drop-down list box by using the addition user command. And we know that whenever we select a value in the drop-down, okay, whether we press enter or don't press enter, since we have attached the function code, the event triggered is what? At selection screen. And the function code of the drop-down list box will be captured in the system field what? Sciucom. Will be captured in the system field sciucom. Okay, so see now, when I execute, no errors. Yeah, by default, all the blocks are what? Invisible. Now see, I'll choose institutes. Just I'll choose the institutes. I'll not press any enter key. So the moment I choose institutes, done. What happened? Without pressing enter key, the appropriate block is made visible. I'll choose locations. Locations block is made visible. I'll choose courses. Courses block is made visible. So what is the summary? The moment you select a value in the drop-down list box, the function, the SAP triggers what event? At selection screen event first. And the function code of the drop-down list box is captured in the system field sciucom. And the key of the selected value is captured in the list box internally. So that's why the logic I'm writing here. The sciucom is FC1. And if the selected value is what? K1. I'm setting the flag variables. And we know that after triggering at selection screen event, the next event triggered is what? At selection screen output. So the screen refreshing logic, we should always write it in the final event. What is the final event which is getting triggered here? At selection screen output. That's it. So any questions so far, please ask me. Sridhar, you have logged in? Sridhar? Right. So now the next requirement is, yesterday for making the blocks visible or invisible, what you are doing, we are checking each and every element. If the screen field name is so and so, okay, we are checking each and every field individually. So now what I'll do is, okay, by default, all the blocks should be what? Invisible. Overall, how many blocks we have? 3 blocks. So what I'll do is, those 3 block elements, I will add it to what? Screen group. I will add it to screen group, three different screen groups. So what is the advantage of adding them to screen group? Okay, instead of checking each and every element in the block, I can compare with the group itself, because anyhow we have to assign common properties. We have to assign common properties for what? Multiple elements in the block. Okay, so we need to what? Instead of checking each and every screen element, I can assign what? Screen group. So what I'll do is, we have three different blocks. For each block element, I'll assign a different group. So how do we assign? See here, this is my first block. How many screen elements we have in that block? Three elements. What kind of elements are? Checkboxes. So I want to assign a screen group for them. Okay, so what I'll do, I'll say, I'll use addition modify ID. I'll give some ID, ID 1. Similarly, for the second checkbox also, I'll say modify ID, ID 1. Then for the third checkbox also, I'll say modify ID, ID 1. Done. And this is radio button group. All these three radio buttons also, I will assign it to a group. How do we assign? We'll use addition modify ID, ID 1. Sorry, I'll assign different group. I'll give ID 2. Then I'll say modify ID, ID 2. Then again, I'll say what? Modify ID, ID 2. So first block elements is link is associated with the screen group ID 1. Second block elements have associated the screen group ID 2. And the third block elements, I will say what? Modify ID, ID 3. Any name you can give. But what is the addition you have to use? Modify ID. Okay. And this is again modify ID, ID 3. So we have three different screen groups, ID 1, ID 2, and what? ID 3. So what is the advantage of assigning them to group? What is the initial requirement? All the three blocks should be invisible. So how do we do it? We are looping the screen internal table. That screen internal table is internally created by SAP based on what? Screen structure, right? So if I go to SC11, let me open that screen structure. Right, this is my screen structure. We have a field what? Name. Okay, already we have seen the field name, we have seen invisible, something like that. Now you can see here we have a field like what? Group one. So what I can do is, here initial requirement is to make all the blocks invisible. So what I'll do, instead of comparing each and every element, any of three blocks should be made what? Invisible. So what I'll do here, I'll say, instead of checking each and every element, I'll say if screen-group1 is equal to what? ID1 or screen-group1 equal to ID2 or screen-group1 equal to ID3. Okay. So if the screen groups are ID1, ID2, and ID3, okay, I am making it as what? Invisible. Understood? So to this screen group ID1, how many elements are there? Some three elements, three checkboxes, here three radio buttons, three comments, three labels. So when I execute now, yes, same thing is achieved. Okay, that is the advantage of what? Screen group. Okay, similarly, what is the next requirement here? Here when I choose this, the second block should be made visible. So what I'll do, let me write the logic. So here, whenever we select, we are setting the appropriate flag. A flag equal to one, I have to make only the block one as visible. So what I can do here, I'll say if screen-name, instead of comparing each and every element, I'll say screen-group one is equal to what? If screen-group1 is equal to, what is that? ID1. Okay, if screen-group1 equal to ID1, or if the element is what? P_ABC, that's nothing but list box. Okay, so done. When I execute, do the same thing for the rest of the elements also. So here visible block 2, here I'll say if screen-group1 is equal to what? ID2. Done. And then for this visual block 3 also, else screen hyphen group 1 is equal to what? ID 3. Done. So when I execute, okay, by default all the three blocks are invisible. I'll choose institutes. Yes, institute block. Oh, okay. So only the elements got made visible, not the block. I'll choose locations. Yeah, so I think for the block also, let me check whether I can assign the screen group. So here for the block also, let me check whether I can assign screen group or not. No, it's not allowing. Then modify id 1. So let me check. No, it is not allowing us to attach the screen group for the, it is not allowing us to attach the screen group for the what, block. So what I'll do is, if you want the block also to be made visible, let me do it individually. So here I'll say visible block 1, yeah, ID 1 or what, screen hyphen name equal to, what is the block name, BK 1, and even the title also, screen hyphen the name equal to, because I am unable to attach the screen group to what, block. What is that title, T1. Done. Or do the same thing for the rest of these things. If screen hyphen name equal to BK2 or what, T2, you make it visible. Similarly for the third block also, screen hyphen name is equal to BK3 or the title is what, T3. Do so and so. Let me save it, check for the syntax. Done. So when I execute, I'll choose instance. Yes, it is made visible. I'll choose locations. Yes, made visible. Courses, made visible. Okay, so this is the advantage of what, grouping the screen elements. How do we group the selection screen elements? By using the addition what, modif ID. By using the addition modif ID. Yeah, Sridhar, have you logged in?
Yes, yes.
Okay, fine. Is it Sridhar or Riyas?
Sridhar Kendri, sir.
Okay, fine. Yeah, fine. Yeah, you can mute your speakers. None. Right, so we understood how to control the visibility of the screen. How to control the visibility of the screen. Okay, how to control that? By looping the screen internal table. Okay, so before I proceed further, any questions in this? Any questions? Okay. Done. So this is about the list box. Now my next requirement is, in the same example, let me try to cover. So this is my what, drop down list box. Where is the focus now? In the drop down list box. Now I'll press F1. Okay, when I press F1, right, I'm pressing F1. Yeah, what is happening here? It is giving me an information saying that no documentation available. Okay, suppose here, if I go back to my initial screen, yeah, the cursor is there in this particular input field. Okay, I'll press F1. If I press F1, when I press F1 key, yeah, I got some information like ABAP program name, the name of the program you want to process. Okay, let me put the focus on the create button. Okay, I'll use the tab. Yeah, create button is selected now. I'll press F1. When I press F1, I got some information. Okay, so what I'm trying to show here is, whenever I press F1, okay, whenever I press F1 on any selection screen element, I'm getting what, some information. So when I press F1 here, by default, I'm getting what, no documentation available. So my requirement is, when I press F1, I have to show some information to the user in the pop-up. Okay, so this is what kind of screen, selection screen. So on the selection screen, if you press F1 key on any screen element, SAP will trigger an event. Okay, what is that event? At selection screen on help request. At selection screen on help request. So already we have handled some events like initialization event, at selection screen event, and what? At selection screen output event. So now let me handle an event called as what? At selection screen on help request. Why I need to handle that particular event? Because we know that whenever we press F1 key on any selection screen element, SAP will trigger an event called as what? At selection screen on help request. So what I'll do here is, let me handle that event. I can handle that event anywhere, but make sure that it is at the end. All the events are at the end of the program. So already we have initialization event, at selection screen event, and at selection screen output. So somewhere here, subroutines, I'm keeping it at the end. So I'll handle an event now. What is this? At selection screen on, what is that event? On help request for, on help request for which screen element you want the F1 help for my drop-down list box. What is the name of my drop-down list box in my program? P_ABC. So I'll say at selection screen on help request for P_ABC. Okay. So let me check whether the event is triggered or not. How do I check it? Just give some message. So I'll say message. Okay. I'll say F1 help for drop-down. I'll give type I. That is nothing but information message. So let me check whether I'm getting the message or not. Right. So earlier when I press F1, what is the message I got on the toolbar, on the status bar? No documentation available. But in this case, I have handled the event called as what? At selection screen on help request for that particular field. So let's see what happened when I press F1. Yes, I'm getting some information message. F1 help for what? Drop down. So what is the meaning? The event got triggered. Similarly, I'll choose institutes. Now I'll use a tab. Which one is selected now? The checkbox is selected. Which checkbox? Sorry, radio button. What is the radio button? Gensoft Technologies. What is the name of this radio button in the program? P_R1. P_R1 is the name of the first radio button in our program. So I want the F1L for this also. So as of now, if you see, let me choose institutes. Which one is selected? I'll use a tab. First radio button is what selected. I'll press F1. Again, what is saying it? No documentation is what available. So let me handle the F1L for that particular screen element also. So you can see it. I'll say at selection screen on help request for, what is the name of the radio button? P_R1. So I'll say F1 help for some message I'll give. Okay, don't worry about the message. First radio button. Okay, similarly I'll handle it for what? Other radio button at selection screen for P_R2. So here I'll say for second radio button. Okay, let me handle it for checkbox also. At selection screen on help request for, what is the checkbox name? First checkbox P_C1. So F1 help for what? First checkbox. So okay, so what I'm trying to show here is for each screen element we have to handle this event separately. Okay, if you observe the other events, initialization event, it is for the entire selection screen. At selection screen, again, it is for the entire selection screen. At selection screen output is again for the entire selection screen. Means these events I need to handle only once. But these events, they are specific to what each element. So we need to handle separately. So let me check it now. No syntax error. When I execute, I'll press F1 for the drop down. Yes, I got F1 for drop down. Let me choose institutes. I'll put the focus on the first radio button. I'll press F1. Yes, F1 for first radio button. I'll put the focus on the second. Okay, it's not coming here. Okay, I'll choose courses. Okay, yeah, which one is selected? Now first checkbox. I'll press F1. F1 for what? Checkbox. Understood? So like this, we need to handle this event separately for each screen element. Now what I want is for the drop down list box, we are just flashing the information message. Instead of flashing the information message, what I'll do is let me comment this. So already we know how to use the standard function models, how to call a function model, call function, VRM underscore set underscore values. We understood the purpose of this particular function model. It is used for what? Populating drop down values for the list box. Okay, similarly, whenever I press F1 key on the what drop down list box, what I'll do is let me call one function model. So where we can see the function models, SE37. If I go to SE37, it will open with the function builder tool. I'll give the function model name. Let me give the function module name as popup to inform. So there is one standard function model. This is another standard function model provided by SAP itself. That's why it is not starting with ZRY. It is starting with other than ZRY. So when I display this, I want to call this particular function model. So already we know before calling the function model, we need to check the signature of the function models. Okay. So if you see the signature, if you go to import section, we have many parameters. Out of many parameters, first three are what? Mandatory. The optional checkbox is not selected. So it is mandatory, obligatory, compulsory. What are the parameter types of title? So title is what is the description they give? Title line of what? Dialog box. Then text one and text two. They didn't give any data type, but we should have that understanding that text one is obviously what? Character. No? All the text are what type? Character. So out of four text parameters, the first two are what? Mandatory. Any export parameters are there? No export parameters. Any changing? Nothing. Any tables? No. Any exceptions? No exceptions. Okay. So let me try to call this particular function model. What is the purpose of this function model? Okay. It will display the dialog box to display what? A message. It will display the dialog box to display a message. So in other programming language, we use alerts. Okay. So here we have what? This function model. So I'll just call the function model. We already know how to call. I'll just go to pattern. What is the function model? Pop up to inform. Pop up to inform. Continue. Done. Call function pop up to inform. So import becomes what? Export title. Okay, since it is mandatory, provide some title. I'll just give some title. F1L for drop down text one. Select a value from drop down. Some text I'm giving, meaningful text. Text two. On selecting, displays what? Appropriate block. On selecting, displays appropriate block. So other two are new optional. I'm not interested. Let me remove this. I'll give the period here. Okay. So from here to here, it is only what? One statement. Okay, so whenever I press F1 key on my drop down list box, what is the event triggered? Add selection screen on help request. So save it, check it, done. When I execute, I'll press F1, done. So I got a dialog box. I got a dialog box. I got the title and what are the text I gave. I got the so what is the purpose of this F1 help? To provide the meaningful information related to that particular element. Okay, for end user perspective, okay, you can press F1 to understand the purpose of that particular element. So as part of that F1 help, you will provide some meaningful text. Okay, that's it. So if I choose this Densoft Technologies, I got what? Message F1 help for fast radio button. So this is about the add selection screen on help request event. Any questions, please ask me. Done. Okay. Now in the same example, let me try to call a thing. So here We already know the purpose of this message, and in the program itself, we are giving the message like F1, L4 checkbox, F something, some messages I'm giving. Okay, some messages I'm giving. So these are what local messages. Since I'm constructing these messages within the program, I am calling it as what local messages. But assume that the same message has to be used in many programs. Same message has to be used in many objects in the project. As part of your project, you'll be developing what many custom objects. Okay, in multiple custom objects, I need to use the same message. So what we can do, we can take a decision to create something called as what message class. Okay, message class. Okay, so what is a message class? As the name itself suggests, message class is a container of what? Messages. It is a container of messages. How do you maintain the message class? By using the T-code SC91. By using SC91, we can create and maintain the message class. In one message class, we can maintain up to 1,000 messages. In one message class, we can maintain up to 1,000 messages. Okay, and the message IDs ranges from 000 to 999. So what is my requirement is, instead of giving these messages locally in the program, I'll create the message class, and as part of that message class, I'll maintain this particular messages, and I'll refer to that message class in my program. So let's see how to do it. Where do we create the message class? By using the transaction code SC91. So let me open SC91. So I'll go to a T-code SC91. Understood? So when do we go for a message class? No one will tell us to create the message class. The development team in the project has to take the decision. If the same messages has to be used across many objects in your project, then we'll take the decision to create the message class so that it can be used by many ABAP consultants across the objects. So I'll go to SC91. Done. It is asking me the message class name. I'll give the message class name as something Z645 message class, any name. Okay, since it is a custom message class, I'm starting with Z645 message class. Right, I'm using the T-code, what T-code? SC91. Click on create. Done. So attributes tab is there, which contains the admin information, who is the user who has created, on which date, all those things. Short text. Some text I'm giving. Done. I'll choose the tab what? Messages tab. So if I go to messages tab, it is asking us to provide the package name. Let me save it in the local objects. Done. Yeah, so you can see here, in one message class we can maintain up to 1,000 messages. What is this? 0002 up to what? 999. So in one message class we can maintain up to 1,000 messages. So what I'll do, just I'll provide some text. Funnel for first checkbox, any message you can maintain. Okay, any meaningful messages. I'll say funnel for what? First radio button. Okay, I'll say record inserted. I'll say record not inserted. Okay, I'll say record deleted. I'll say record not deleted. Like this, I can maintain up to what? 1,000 different messages. So my message class is created. How many messages I maintained? Around 6 messages, and these are my message IDs. Let me save it. Done. So messages are what? Saved. Now I need to use this message in my program. So what I'll do here, I want to make use of this particular message, FNL for first checkbox. What is the message ID? 000. So here, instead of giving the message locally, I'll just comment it. I want to make use of the message in the message class. I'll say message. And when you're using the messages of message class, I repeat, when you're using the messages of message class, we need to provide the message type, like whether you want to show it as an information message or warning message or error message, abort message, status message, something like that. I want to flash this as information message. So I'll say message I indicate solve. Information message. What is the message you want to use? 000. Because I want to flash this particular message. So I 000 in the parentheses. I'll say what? Z645 MSG class. So what is the syntax? What is the syntax for using the message of the message class? You have to say message. Okay. Then what? Message type. And then you have to say what? Message ID, no space. Then in the parentheses, you have to provide what? Message class. Message class. Okay. Message type can be what? Information message, warning message, status message, abort message, all those, error message, all those things. So I'm giving what? So and so. Similarly, for this one, let me use status message. Message SL. So S indicates what? Status message. What is the message ID you want to flash? 001. So I'll say S001. I'll say Z645. What? Message class. Done. Let me save it. Check for the syntax error. Activate this. Done. When I execute, yeah, see now. I'll just choose institutes. Okay, I'll put the focus on the first radio button. I'll press F1. Yeah, what I got? F1L for first radio button. Where I got it? On the status bar, because I'm using what? Status message. Let me choose courses. Yeah, I'll put the focus on the first checkbox. I'll press F1. Yes, I got the information message. So once the messages are maintained in the message class, when you're using that message in the object, in the program, I can use the appropriate message type depending on the severity you want to show. If you want to show it as information message, you'll give it as I. If you want to show it as error message, you'll give what? E. Like this, we'll come across many message types going forward. Information message, error message, warning message, status message, abort message. That's it. So that is about the message class. I'll just summarize. Message class is the container of messages. By using the T code SC91, we can create and maintain the message class. As part of one message class, we can maintain up to 1,000 messages. And the message IDs ranges from 000 to what? 999. Okay. And when you are using the messages of the message class, we have to provide the appropriate message types. We have different types of message types like information message, warning message, error message, abort message, and what? Status message. Depending on the severity of the message, we need to decide what message type you want to use. That's it. Any questions? Right, so now let us focus on some parts of debugging. See, just try to understand. We already know what is the purpose of debugging. Okay, by debugging a program, we can check how the program is executing internally. We can check the flow of what? Program execution. We can check how the control is shifting from one part of the program to another part of the program. We can check where the variable values are getting changed. Okay, so let me debug this program. Okay, in order to debug the program, first of all, you have to activate the program and we need to set the breakpoint at the appropriate place. Okay, it's not compulsory to debug the entire program. We can debug from a specific part of a program. For debugging from anywhere, we have to set what? Breakpoint. A breakpoint is a signal to the system. Okay, whenever the breakpoint is encountered, what happens? The control will be taken to a debugging mode. Once a control is entered into debugging mode, we can use different function keys to debug the program. So far, we were using only F5 for debugging the program. So now what I'll do is, I'm interested to debug these events. Okay, So I'll put the breakpoint in the initialization event. Let me put the breakpoint in the at selection screen event. I'll put the breakpoint in at selection screen output event. I'll also put the breakpoint in what? At selection screen on help request for. So what I'm trying to show is I'm setting multiple breakpoints. Okay. Right. So now when I execute, what happens? It will stop at the what? Before display, whenever you execute, the selection screen has to be displayed. Na? Right. Before displaying the selection screen, what are the events triggered? Before displaying the selection screen for the first time, two events get triggered, initialization event and what? At selection screen output event. So wantedly, I gave breakpoint for all these four events. Let me check where it will stop. So when I press F8 for execution, yeah, you can see it is stopping at what? Initialization, because this is the first event triggered. This is the first event triggered before displaying the selection screen. Where is the arrow pointer now? It is about to call one subroutine by using the perform keyword. I am trying to call a subroutine. So already we know whenever we call a subroutine, where the control will jump to the subroutine definition. So how do we execute one step at a time? By pressing what? F5 key. Okay, so what I'll do is let me press F5. When I press F5, see where the control jumps. Yes, control is jumping to what? Subroutine definition. Now do we debug one step at a time by pressing what? F5. So before that, do we have any interest in the internal table? T underscore else is what? Initial. So let me press F5. Okay, I'm preparing the work area. Key is K1 and text I'm preparing F5. I'm pressing F5. F5 will execute what? Single step. I can click on this button or I can directly press F5 on my keyboard. So I'm trying to append it to my internal table. So I'll say F5. I got one entry. Okay, so this subroutine has got many statements. Already I have entered inside the subroutine. So if I press F5, it will execute what? One statement at a time. Now I am not interested to debug the rest of my subroutine. I am not interested to debug the rest of the subroutine. I want the control to be exited. I want the control to be exited from the current subroutine. Okay, understood. We are adding how many entries? Three entries we are adding, and we are calling the function model. I am not interested to debug the rest of the subroutine. So, but already the control is there inside what? Subroutine, inside form and form. So if you want to come out of any block, when I say block, it can be a subroutine, it can be a function module, or it can be a method. If you want to come out of any block, you have to press what? F7. So you see here on the application toolbar, we have a button what? Return, F7. When you press F7, the control comes out of what? Current block. What is my current block? Prepare values. So we have some rest of the statements. Na? Those statements will be executed internally. So as of now, my internal table contains only one entry. So since I press F7, the rest of the statements of that block will be executed internally. So let me say F7. Done. So you can see here, it has added how many more entries? Two more entries. Understood? Where it is coming? To the next statement. The control has came out of the subroutine. So I repeat, F5 is used for what? Executing. F5 is used for executing single statement at any point of time. And when we use F7, we use F7 when you want to come out of the current block. Block can be a subroutine or a method or a function module. Okay, if you're not interested to debug the entire block at any point of time, you can come out of the current block by pressing what? F7. Done. So hope it's clear up to this. F5 and F7. Okay, now see the next thing. I'll press F5 now. So when I press F5, again, what you are doing here? We are trying to call a subroutine. So control jumps to what? Control jumps to what? Subroutine definition. But I am not interested to debug this subroutine. So I know that when I press F7, control jumps to the definition, but I'm not interested to debug this subroutine. So what I'll do, I'll press F6. We have another key called what? F6. What is this F6? F6 is also similar to F5. F6 is also similar to F5. So when I say similar to F5, F6 also will execute what? One statement at a time, but F6 will behave differently at the time of calling the block. Means at the time of calling a block, if you press F5, what happens? Control jumps to what? Block definition. But if you press F6 at the time of calling the block, control will not jump to block, but internally that block gets executed without going to that particular block definition. So since I'm not interested to debug this block, I'll press what? F6. So what happens when I press F6 now? Internally to execute this block. What is the logic we wrote inside this block? We have made all the three blocks to be what? Invisible. So that gets what? Executed. So I'll say F6. Done. See it? Control is not going to the block definition, but internally that block got executed. Okay. Now I'll press F5 or F6. Doesn't matter, because this is a normal statement. So I can press either F5 or F6. For normal statement, F5 and F6 will behave same. It will execute what? One statement. But F6 will behave differently only at the time of what? Calling the blocks. Means instead of jumping to the block definition, internally it executes the block. So let me press F5. Yes, it is executed one statement. Let me press F6. Yes, it is executed one statement. So F5 and F6 will behave same at the time of what? Executing a normal statement. Okay, done. Okay, so there are many other statements in my event. I am not interested. To debug the rest of the statements in my event. So I'll press F8. So when I press F8 now, what happens? It will check whether any breakpoint is available in the queue. If the breakpoint is available, it will stop at the next breakpoint. Otherwise, it executes the entire program. Understood? At any point of time, if you press F8, what happens? The control jumps to next breakpoint if available. Otherwise, it executes the entire program as a single step. So let me press F8 now. So when I press F8, do we have further breakpoints in the program? Yes. I gave the breakpoint for at selection screen event. I gave the breakpoint for at selection screen on help request. I gave the breakpoint for at selection screen output also. So let's see where it will stop. So I'll press F8. Good. Where it is stopping? At selection screen output. Why only at selection screen output? Already we know, before showing the selection screen to the user, what are the two events gets triggered internally? First is initialization event. Next is what? At selection screen output. That's why the control is stopping it or at selection screen output event. Okay, done. Now let me check the value of flag. What is the value of flag? 0. So I'm checking the condition. I'll press F5. Since if condition not satisfied, what is the value of flag? 0. Since if condition not satisfied, the control jumps to what? Next condition. Okay, see here, I'll press F5. Done, it is jumping to the next condition. This is also not satisfied now. I'll press F5. Not satisfied. I'll press F5. So none of the if block got executed. So control is coming out. See the arrow pointer. Control is coming out of what? At selection screen output. So when I press F5, it is going to some standard code. Which you need not debug. Understood? Which you need not debug. So already my two events got debugged. Initialization event and what? At selection screen output. So I'm not interested in this. So I'll press F8. So what happened? My selection screen got displayed. So what is understanding? Before showing the selection screen to the user for the first time, two events got triggered, initialization event and what? At selection screen output. Even though I gave the breakpoint for all the four events, it has executed only two events. Okay, done. Now I'll choose what? A value. The moment I choose a value in the drop down list box, what happens? SAP triggers what event? At selection screen event, and the function code of this dropdown is captured in the system field SciUCOM, and the key of the selected value is captured in the list box internally. After triggering at selection screen, where it has to jump to the at selection screen output. Okay, so see here, the moment I choose is institutes, good, where it is stopping in the at selection screen. Why only at selection? Because that is the first event triggered the moment you select a value in the drop-down list box. What is the function code of the drop-down list box? FC1, where the function codes get captured in the runtime SciUCOM. If you see the value of SciUCOM, what is the value? FC1. Which value I selected? Institutes. What is the key of that institutes? K2, na? That K2 will go and sit in the list box internally. Na? See the value of P_ABC. Yes, P_ABC is what? K2. Done. So I'll press F5. What is the value of SciUCOM? FC1. Do you have when FC1? Yes. Right? I'll press F1. Yes. When directly is going to what? When FC1. Yes, condition is satisfied. I'm checking the value of P_ABC. What is the value of P_ABC? K2. So this if condition is not satisfied, I'll press F1. It is going to the next else if. This condition is satisfied, I'll press F5. Since the condition is satisfied, it is entering that if block. It is entering that if block, and it will set the flag value to how much? 2. What is the current value of flag? 0. I'll press F5. Yes, flag value is what? 2. Okay, done. I'll press F5. Done. Control is coming out of what? At selection screen event. After at selection screen event, what is the next event triggered? At selection screen output event. So see now, when I press F5, done, you can see now where it is going to the at selection screen output. Okay, so at selection screen output will be triggered twice. First time before showing the selection screen, and every time after triggering what? At selection screen. What is the value of flag in the memory? 2, na? So it is checking the first condition, it is not satisfied. I'll press F5. It is going to the second condition. Yes, satisfied. Done. I am calling the subroutine. If I press F5, control jumps to what? Control jumps to what? Subroutine definition. Yes, I am interested to debug this subroutine. Let the control jump to subroutine definition. So I'll say F5. Done. Control is jumping to what? Control is jumping to what? That subroutine definition. I am looping the screen internal table. Okay, so if you see here, okay, if I go to table section, what is the screen internal table? This is my screen structure. Okay, since I have not created that internal table, it is not showing that content. It is not showing that particular content. It is an implicitly created internal table. Done. I am looping the screen. So already we know the concept of loop. Whenever we loop, what happens? Each record will come to what? Header. So I'll say F5. Yes. So see the value of group one. What is the value of group one? Space. Okay. What is the value of screen-name? SSR fields-UCOM. So I'm checking the condition. If screen-group1 equal to ID2, or if the name is either BK2 or T2 or so and so, go inside. So, but what is the name here? SSR fields-UCOM. What is the group one value? Space. So none of my if condition is satisfied. None of my R block is satisfied. So when I say F5, since nothing is satisfied, control is going to what? Else part. So I am setting invisibly equal to 1 and updating the internal table. Then again, since we are in the loop, I'll say F5, loop at screen. What is the next group one? Space again, name is again so and so. This is not satisfied, control goes to else part. Done. F5. Again, I am looping. See here now. What is the group one name? Space. What is the name here? P_ABC. So one of the R condition is what? Satisfied. R means what? If any one of the condition is satisfied, it will enter that particular block. So since this condition is satisfied, it will enter the if block. Done. I am setting invisibly equal to 0. Where it will update? In the work area level. From work area, we have to update the internal table. Done. Like this, the screen internal table will be iterated. I am not interested to debug the rest of the program. At any point of time to come out of the debugging, you have to press what? F8. So if you press F8, I got that. Okay. So what we understood from the debugging is the functionality of F5, F6, F7 and F8. F5 will always execute what? Single statement at a time. F6 also will execute single statement at a time. but F6 will behave differently at the time of calling a block. That is, when you press F6 at the time of calling a subroutine or a function module or a method, the control will not jump to block definition. Instead, the entire block will be executed as a single step. Then F7. When we use F7, when you want to come out of any block, if the control is inside a block, if you want to come out of the current block, you can press F7. Okay. If you press F7 outside the block, doesn't have any effect. F7 we generally use inside the block only. If you press F7 outside the block, nothing will happen. Okay. If you press F7 inside the block, the control comes out of the current block. And when you press F8, what happens? The control jumps to next breakpoint if available, or else the entire program will be executed as a single step. Then we have other things here like watch point that I'll cover it in 1 or 2 days in the debugging only. And how to change the program variable values in the runtime in the debugging mode, that also will come in next 1 or 2 days. Any questions? Done. And one more small information. I may take the class on this Saturday. Okay, I'll confirm it tomorrow. I may take the class on this Saturday. Okay, anyhow, I'll confirm that tomorrow. Okay, so I'll stop it now. Probably from tomorrow onwards, we'll start either with a dictionary objects or with a database programming. Done. Chalo then, so I'll wind off. We'll continue tomorrow.